the heart of the river. "This is the place I told you about," my friend said. "This is the heart of the river." We leaned against the hood of the truck for a few minutes, watching the water, feeling the heat of the engine and the coolness of the air. As we rigged our rods, the river began to come alive. A few caddisflies danced in the shafts of early evening light that pushed through the spruce trees on the far bank. One caddis touched the surface to lay her eggs, and a trout lunged and missed. "My favorite pool's downstream," my friend called as she disappeared around the bend. "Fish the pocket water upstream. You should do well." I crossed to the other side, picking my way through the heavy current. As I started to walk the bank, my head was filled with the sounds of the river. After a while, I noticed a fish rising in a deep slick. The fish was sipping deliberately, nosing the surface. What was this fish rising to with such persistence? Certainly not caddis, which provoked trout into reckless, slashing rises. I squinted to see, but the sun was over my shoulder now, and I couldn't pick out any insects in the air. That morning, in one of those idle fly shop conversations, a guy had mentioned that he'd seen flying ants on the water. "You know," he said, "the big rusty ones." I didn't know, in fact. But I had a few furry little ant patterns in my box, so I tied one on. The fish was still rising. Why did he have to be so damn far away? And to complicate things, there was a fast tongue of current between me and the slick where the trout was feasting. A reach cast might work. If it was long enough, I might get a few seconds of natural drift before my fly was swept out of the slick. I can do this, I thought. If I'm lucky. Maybe. One false cast, then another, then the forward cast. As the loop shot forward, I swept my hand toward my left shoulder to create some slack in the line. The fly landed, drifted a few inches, and the fish took it.